Oh, there is no greater love than oh, there is no greater love than love that framed the ages, love that purchased me, love that called out to me. What tender mercy, what tender mercy. I will sing of your mercy, I will sing of your mercy, I will sing of your mercy. Of the sand of the sea, how precious your thoughts towards me. So I'll sing of your love forever. I'll sing of your love. I'll sing of your love forever. I'll sing of your love forever. Oh, for when I was without hope, hope came to me. You rescued me. When I was without strength, strength came to me. Oh, Jesus.
For this great love, or with you've loved us. thank you for every drop of blood shed at Calvary's cross to redeem us, Lord. There is none like you in all heaven or in earth. There is no God like our God. We praise you, Lord Jesus, tonight. We're here tonight because of you and what you've done for us. Unto you alone that loved us and washed us from our sins in your own blood. We give you glory and honor. We praise you, Lord Jesus. Oh, Father, we love you. Father, thank you for sending Jesus. Jesus, thank you for sending the Holy Ghost. And I thank you, Lord, that there is no place like the abiding place. I thank you for the church. I thank you for this church, especially the Lord. Praise the Lord. We welcome everyone tonight. You may be seated. Wow. Wow, try and just like minister after that. I can like hardly stand. I'm just like, woo. Oh, Father, thank you for the worship team. I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed beyond words. Oh, my. Because each one brings something. They bring that which they have labored for to worship their King with. And so when it comes together collectively, it's bigger than an atomic bomb. You know, it's just so beautiful to me. And it's just all the more so beautiful to the Lord for us to just be pouring out our worship. He seeks those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When our Lord and Savior came to earth, we're thankful that he came to earth. He had one central theme to all his messages. Heaven, a kingdom to come. I have one central theme I want to minister to you tonight. Three guesses what it is. Heaven, a kingdom to come. Psalm 90, verse 12 says, so teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Now, there are three key words in that power-packed verse. Teach, hearts, and wisdom. So, let's take the word teach. A heart of humility has a teachable spirit. A heart of humility is willing to be taught instruction. Hallelujah. Proverbs 6:23 says, reproofs of instruction are the way of life. That is a radical verse. I only want things that pertain unto life and godliness. Psalm 25, verses 4 and 5 says, and this is a prayer that I actually pray regularly because I just love it. And when I hit my knees first thing in the morning, it's usually one that I'm consistent to say to the Lord. It says, show me thy ways. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth. This is 100% truth. And teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. On you do I wait all the day. And in Matthew 28:18-20, it says, all power in heaven, this is the key part, and in earth is given unto me. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. See, we serve the God of the limitless. He doesn't just limit it to your neighborhood or your block, or your city, or your state, or your country. He says, all nations. So we are the body of Christ. So if everyone takes a nation, that which is laid upon your heart, we we will have this gospel preached throughout all the world. Hallelujah. So, precious Jesus, when he was growing up, he was taught by Joseph, who was his father figure, and he was in complete submission to Joseph. But he invested his whole life into being taught of his heavenly father. So let's look at the word hearts. The Lord looks at the heart, not the head. We know in 1 Samuel 16, verse 7, it says, "The Lord sees not as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Hallelujah. 2 Chronicles 16, 9 says, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth." He covers a lot of territory, seeking those whom he may show, be strong on their behalf, to those who have a perfect heart toward him. He's looking for that perfect heart. He told Abraham, "I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect." If it was not possible for Abraham to walk perfectly, God would not have requested that of him. He has requested of you to walk perfectly before him. And he's given you the perfect heart to do it. Proverbs 4:23, "Guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life." Proverbs 23:7, "As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he." Romans 10:10, "With the heart, man believes unto righteousness." Ezekiel 36:26, "When you were born again, when you were born from above and became a new creation, the first thing that you were given was a new heart." Hallelujah. Thank you for the new heart, Lord. And in Luke 10:27, it says that we are to love the Lord our God, and the first thing that we are to love him with listed is our heart. Okay, wisdom. Wisdom is the principal thing. Get wisdom, and with all you're getting, get understanding. Do you want to be happy? Of course you want to be happy. Happy is the man that finds wisdom and that gets understanding. Wisdom is better than silver. It is better than gold. It is better than it is better than rubies. It is better than, and this is good, this is powerful, it is better than strength. Little Holy Ghost laughter session from me. I love you, Jesus, and I thank you for my children, because there is no love on earth like the way a parent can love a child. And so it's just a foretaste of how much the Father loves us, his sons and his daughters. And I love being the handmaiden of the Lord. You can't say that. You have to say, you women, that you're the handmaiden. But I get to say, I'm a brand new Anne. I'm a handmaiden. So back to wisdom. Yes, stay on track. No rabbit trail. Pastor Mark, he gets 5 stories going at once. It's just a sign and a wonder. And then he circles back around and he finishes the story. It's great. Oh, but anyway. So wisdom is better than strength. And so what I was going to say was, it would have been marvelous if Samson had coupled wisdom with his strength. And wisdom is better than weapons of war. Hallelujah. All the things that you can desire cannot be compared to her. Length of days is in her right hand, and in her left hand are riches and honor. And all her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all of her paths lead to peace. I was so blessed by the sermon that Pastor Elizabeth ministered the other night on peace. I was just so blessed. She not only smiled the whole time, but she said something so simple and so profound, and it just really struck me. So let me just tell you what it was, so it can strike you as well if it didn't that evening. She said, "Just as we are to walk in divine love, no less are we to walk in divine peace. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee." trust ye in the Lord Jehovah, for in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. Take that, devil, you weakling. We've got everlasting strength in our God. He is so good. He is so good. The devil is a coward. He's a weakling. He is everything the opposite of God. So we are strong in the strength of the Lord and in the power of his might. So the devil has no strength, none, zilcho, and he has no might. So you're king of the mountain when it comes to being against him. All right. You know, I never did tell you what this title is message of the title. The title of the message is, Elizabeth, you just got. It's amazing. My child got me drunk in the Holy Ghost with one little sign that said, so good. You know how we love to be encouraged? This is 66 books of encouragement, but I'm going to tell it myself. When I told Elizabeth that I was going to be ministering, I said, I need to make you a sign. And she paused, looked a little stunned. And I said, yes, I need you to make you a sign. A sign that says, you're doing great. And I want you to hold it up every 10 minutes while I'm ministering. So a moment ago, when you were all just captivated with the wisdom that was coming forth, she holds up this little sign that says, so good. So she and I knew, which she and I knew. Okay, in 10 minutes, bring it back. Bring it out of there. All right. I'll try not to do the tongue twister again here. If I were to entitle this message tonight, it would be having a good time in Jesus. No, that is not the title of this message. We'll do that one next week. All of you can make signs. Okay, serious. Be sober. Be sober, Pastor, and be sober. Be sober. Pastor Mark will be here in a short amount of time, and I've got to be done before he comes. And I think I really need to hurry, because what Cade will do is Cade will put this service on as soon as he picks him up at the airport, driving here. So I've got to. I'll have to call Pastor Daniel up quickly. All right. Thank you, Lord. This is so good. This, you do not know what this feels like. If I could get every person in an Alcoholics Anonymous, edit this out, in an Alcoholics Anonymous class to come and feel what I'm feeling up here on this platform right now, they would never turn to that debauchery ever. Ever again. Because our God knows what is great. He knows. We're fearfully and wonderfully made. And so he knows just what our bodies need. And he fills us up with his presence, and it just explodes you. All right, title of this message. Carry on. Christian soldiers. The ants go marching one by one. Consider the ant. I'm Ant. Ann, hi, nice to meet you. Where did that come from? Okay. All right. We're pulling ourselves together now. This has never happened before. This is great. This is great. This is great. Usually only in a ladies' meeting, because we don't film those. All right, the title of this message, if I can remember what the title of this message was. Ah, yes. Preparing for heaven 24/7. Hallelujah. James 1:22 says, be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. There is no greater wisdom than being a doer. And we can get this out. Hearer of the word of God. You are called to be a doer. You are called to be a hearer. You are called to be a teacher. You are not called to be a goofball like somebody is kind of acting like. And if you do and teach men God's commandments, he will call you great in the kingdom of God. Now, if you have been faithful to obey the pastor and have been reading Matthew 5, 6, and 7 on a daily basis, which he said will change your life, and yes, it will, you will know that that's right where I got that from, Matthew 5, 19. So tonight, I beseech you, by the mercies of God, he said to present yourself a living sacrifice. Well, I thought that was so great how Paul opened that up that I thought I would use it too. That you be a doer and a hearer of a verse of scripture that is imperative. And I need to get serious because this is like, if I had to take one of the most serious verses in the entire Bible, this is the most serious one. It is found in Amos 4:12. And you don't need to turn there, Brad Scott. Don't get started. And it says, prepare to meet your God. I told you it was serious. All right. Prepare to meet your God. Hebrews 10:31 says it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. But I say, fear not, for the living God is the loving God, and nothing can separate you from his love. Go read Romans 8:38 and 39. It gives the list of the things that nothing can separate you from. It is radical. It just is edifying. It is exhorting. There is none like you, Lord. So, fear not. If you prepare to meet your God, then it will be the most glorious moment that you poured your life into experiencing when you get there and stand before him. Why is there great wisdom for God's saints to prepare to meet their God? Keyword, prepare. This is why. 1 Peter 4:7 says the end of all things is at hand. That is sobering. Matthew 3:2 says that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Revelation 1:1 says, show unto God's servants those things that must shortly come to pass. And Revelation 3:11 says, behold, I come quickly. I love God's version of quickly. A day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day. 1 John 2:18 says, this is the last time. In Revelation 22:12, I come quickly, and my reward is with me. God loves to reward. Remember, he rewards the diligent seeker in Hebrews 11:6. And my reward is with me to give every man according as his works shall be. You do not want wood, hay, and stubble as your works. They will burn up. You want the precious things that won't burn up. So preparing causes you to be ready and confident, right? Of course, right. So let me give an example. If you are taking, how many of you are in school? How many of you are college students in here tonight? Oh, very good. You will just love this example from Pastor Ram. If you're taking a final exam and you're on the semester basis, and you have diligently studied all semester, you're going to go in and you're going to ace that test. But if you have procrastinated, slackers unite tomorrow, then you are going to come to the 11th hour, the night before the exam, and you are going to pull an all-nighter. How many of you have pulled an all-nighter? How many have you drunk poison to help keep you awake for that all-nighter? Yes, you know exactly what I'm thinking of. Coffee. Those words should be synonymous. Coffee, poison, ye shall surely die. Yeah. Oh my. So, it does not pay off to wait until the 11th hour and stay up all night, because I have found that by the time the next morning comes around, you go in to take that test and you have about 15% recall because your poor little body is so exhausted from being up all night. It defeats the whole purpose anyway, right? Right. So students, be diligent throughout the semester. Do not wait till the last minute. Okay, so the point I am making is if it is important to prepare in the natural for all different things, a test was just a nice little example to give, how much more is it imperative to prepare for the spiritual things? John 12:48 tells me that in the Word of God, that the Word of God will judge me in the last day. This is my open book exam. This is what I will be judged with. Nothing but this. Just one book that's containing 66 books. So, please, do not wait till the 11th hour. Don't wait till you're on your deathbed, please. Now, if today you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Today is the day of salvation. Study to show yourself approved. Not under Pastor Mark, not unto any teacher here on earth, unto God. A workman or a workwoman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. It clarifies rightly because obviously you could wrongly divide the word of truth. But you've got the indwelling Holy Ghost who leads and guides you into all truth. He'll teach you. He'll teach you how to divide it properly. So the Word of God is my how to prepare for heaven 24/7 manual. You know, it is amazing how one book can be so many manuals. It's not only my how to prepare for heaven 24/7 manual. It's my how to have days of heaven on earth manual. It's my how to have a perfect marriage manual. I mean, the list just, how to raise perfect children. Oh, yes, yes, yes. We'll stop right there. We shan't embarrass the children. So the Old and New Testament is filled with godly men and women who prepared to meet their God. So I want to just highlight three. Jesus, when he was being interrogated by Pilate in John 18:36, he said, "My kingdom is not of this world." Abraham in Hebrews 11:10, "For he looked for a city that hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God." And Paul in Philippians 3:10 and 11, I really think that Pastor Mark and Brother Paul will be best friends in heaven because they are so passionately in love with their God, so full of zeal, both of them with knowledge. They'll probably be speaking all of those lovely little languages that they learned down here too. Where's Cade? So Brother Paul said that I may know him in the power of his resurrection. I love how he lists that first. In the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. In verse 11, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Whew, hallelujah. And let me just take a little side note here. Do you know that you are filled with so much resurrection life from the moment that you gave your heart to the Lord, that you should be imparting resurrection life to everyone that you come in contact with? Yeah. Yes. So why did Paul pour his life into preparing to meet his God? So that he could live in heaven, a kingdom to come. Hallelujah. So will you be added to the list of those who prepared to meet their God? Will your testimony be that of 2 Corinthians 4:18? For we look not at the things that are seen, but at the things that are not seen. For the things that are seen are temporal. That's why we said not five times. We don't want the temporal. We look at the things that are not seen because they are eternal. Hallelujah. Colossians 3:1. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Seek first the kingdom. Seek first his righteousness. Hebrews 13:14. Is this your testimony? For we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. Do you know what one of my very favorite things, not a thing, but a part of a verse, it is a verse, and I'm not sure where it is right now. If I knew it like John 3:16 right now, I couldn't tell you what it was. But one of the names of the city, we know New Jerusalem is one of the names of the city, but it says, the Lord is here, as one of the names of the city. That is like so magnificent. I mean, too bad we're named City of San Diego. I mean, but you know what? The Lord is here. Moving right along. We are sojourners just passing through. We are too blessed to be stressed. We will triumph over every challenge and over every circumstance of life in the strength of the Lord and in the power of his might. We will handle every challenge of life just like a hurdle. I used to run hurdles in track. I know that just amazes you. But I did. I loved doing hurdles. Ruth did hurdles. She loved doing hurdles. And so I just look at the challenges of life like hurdles. What do you do with hurdles? You jump over a hurdle one at a time. And then there's another one in front of you, but the one that you just jumped over is behind you. So jump over your hurdles of life, quoting Psalm 18:29. For by thee I have run through a troop, and by my God I have leaped over a wall. Hallelujah. It is the Lord that girds me with strength. He gives me hinds feet to walk upon the high places. You'll find the high places in the secret place. Psalm 27:1, the Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And I love Psalm 18:1. I will love you, O Lord, by strength. The Lord says in Isaiah 28:6, he gives strength to those who turn the battle to the gate. Hallelujah. That's the abiding place. The joy of the Lord is our strength. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Okay. This is, you're going to like this part. Prophesy. I want to talk about PCL. No, not PTL. We know, praise the Lord, PTL. This is PCL. What in heaven's name, Pastor Ed, is PCL? I'm glad you asked. PCL is the acronyms for patience, capacity, level. And everyone exercises varying degrees of their PCL. But we're commanded to run this race with patience, this race that is set before us. It's not how you start a race that is emphasized. It is how you cross that finish line that is emphasized. So we're running an endurance race. He that shall endure until the end, the same shall be saved. So we have many situations in life where patience gets to have her perfect work. And our patience capacity level is tested. So waiting in line is a perfect example. Waiting in line at red lights. Have you noticed? I'm sure I'm not the only one that has had this experience. When you are not in a hurry, all the lights are green, naturally. But when you are late, they are always red. Waiting in line to pump gas, waiting in line to order food at the drive-thrus. Okay, this is my favorite. Waiting in line in the airport and going through the security check, you're late to board your plane, almost to the point of being so late that they're about to call your name. And the TSA pulls your carry-on aside and I like organization. Everything was, past tense, was immaculately packed and organized in my carry-on. But I had something on my carry-on that was definitely going to blow up the entire plane and everybody on that plane. Do you know what that was? My organic mustard. So I'm late for my flight, and they're pulling my suitcase, and the organic mustard is the culprit. Okay, so my patience capacity level was at a height at that point. So waiting in line at the grocery store, waiting in line at the bank, waiting in line at the post office. And you will turn into Ebenezer Scrooge at Christmas time at the post office, because usually it will wrap around the building. So waiting in line at the DMV, that has to be the worst, waiting in line at the DMV. So face it, we are always in a hurry. Our PCL, our patience capacity level, is always being put to the test. We are easily frustrated. We were hearers and not doers only of Pastor Elizabeth's beautiful message on peace. We refuse to meditate on Job 17:7, where it says that the Lord tries us every moment. But we should have meditated on how that the Lord equips us every moment. Hallelujah. But there is coming a day when I guarantee you will all be standing in a line. And the last thing on earth you will want is for it to move in a hurry. In fact, your favorite scripture that will come to your heart will be, prefer your brother before yourself. That line that you will inevitably waiting in is found in Hebrews 9:27. It says, for it is appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. The judgment seat of Christ. The line you'll inevitably be waiting in is the judgment seat of Christ. Romans 14:10 speaks of it. 2 Corinthians 5:10 speaks of it. So will your judgment day be terrifying or will it be glorious? You decide according to how you prepare now. Failure to prepare is preparing to fail. So prepare daily by boldly coming in to the throne of grace that Hebrews 4:16 speaks of. So if you stand before God unprepared and trusting in you, that day is going to be terrifying. But if you stand before God on Judgment Day and you have prepared and you have lived Colossians 3:2, you are hid in Him, then it will be a glorious day. Jeremiah 17:7 says, blessed is the man that makes the Lord the sole object of his trust. So you can cancel earthly appointments. You can cancel an appointment with Dr. Stu. You can cancel an appointment with a dentist. That is a very good one to cancel. You can cancel an appointment with a teacher conference. You can cancel an appointment for a counseling session with Pastor Mark. But there is one appointment that God has set up for you that you cannot cancel. You will be there. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the judgment seat. Thank you, Lord. So, wisdom dictates, we can get it out. Taking Galatians 6, 7 through 9 very seriously. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. If he sows to the flesh, he's going to reap corruption. But if he sows to the Spirit, he's going to reap everlasting life. And I love verse 9. It says, and let us not weary in well-doing, preparing to meet our God. For in due season, we shall reap if we faint not. key to not fainting, Isaiah 40:31. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So as you sow daily to having heaven on earth, which is found centering your whole life around Jesus by the power of the Holy Ghost, you will reap dwelling eternally in the new heavens and the new earth. So one of the very first things when I get to heaven I am going to do is I am going to look into the eyes of my Father. I'm sure his eyes are blue-green like mine. I am going to look into the eyes of the Lord Jesus. Historians say that his eyes were blue. And I'm going to look into the eyes of the precious Holy Spirit. And I'm sure his eyes are brown, like Pastor Mark and Pastor Ruth. And I am going to tell them, thank you. Thank you for this great plan of salvation so that I can spend eternity dwelling in your kingdom of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. I am going to tell them that I love them. It is one thing when your spouse, your husband, your wife, or your children, your dearest friends, when they say I love you by text or by phone, but when they say I love you and look you eye to eye, the impact that that has, nothing can be compared to that. So when God has something so indescribable to pour out, he describes it in his word as unspeakable. It's too wonderful. It's too holy to put a description on that could do it justice. So that's why 2 Corinthians 9:15 says, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. And thank you, Lord, for unspeakable joy. 1 Peter 1:8 says, whom having not seen, you love. In whom, though now you see him not, yet believing you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Hallelujah. So I will say thank you and I will say I love you. So we want to go from glory to glory. We want to go from strength to strength. We want to go from faith to faith. And that is only done by looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. We want to be so consecrated to the Holy Spirit to teach us to apply our hearts unto wisdom, the wisdom of preparing to meet our God. I want to close with the verse of scripture found in 1 Timothy 6, verse 11. First Timothy six, verse 11. But thou, O man of God, flee these things. And that was, those things are given in the previous verses. And follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. Lay hold on preparing to meet your God. Lay hold on eternal life. Lay hold on preparing for heaven 24/7, and lay hold on heaven, a kingdom to come.
Hallelujah. Oh, well, thank you, Jesus. You know, Pastor Mark told me one time, he said, don't ever get up and just talk. Unless you have something to say, like a fire shut up in your bones, just stay seated. Oh, God's good. I won't go there right now. Hallelujah. Come up, Sammy. For those of you who don't know, this is my lovely wife, Summer. She is an amazing blessing. Beyond words. Greetings from Bly, Oregon. We're down for just a few days. We got to celebrate. Rue's getting ready to have a baby, so down just to visit and just participate in what's going on in the local church. But God has sent us out. God has commissioned us to do something, and that is to start a church, and that is taking place out in Bly, Oregon. And we're excited about it. We have been commissioned to go. We didn't get upset at the pastor and leave our church to go do our own thing. We've been sent out. And I want to make sure that everybody in here can get a hold of that realm of authority that you can step into. I have a mantle of authority placed on me for no other reason than I learned how to serve the authority. If you look at Matthew chapter 6, when the centurion comes to Jesus, man, the description of what takes place and his understanding of authority, Jesus says, man, I haven't found so great a faith in all of Israel. The centurion comes to him and says, you don't need to come to my house. I'm a man under authority, and I have men under my authority. You speak the word only, and I know it's going to happen. Incredible, the realms of the authority that God has placed in our lives to go on his behalf, where we know we're under his authority, and we know that we have authority over those under us. So learning to step into that, move in that, something that's wonderful. Just kind of waiting on the Holy Spirit here. If I look like I don't know what I'm doing, you're exactly right. Father's got some awesome things planned for tonight. Honestly, I was hoping we were just going to, I knew Pastor Mark would be here around 8, 8:30. I was hoping we were going to worship the whole time. Some of you need to get in better shape because you are looking exhausted. When Joshua and I grew up through like, man, when we were doing the meetings, the early 2000s, like if we didn't have a two-hour worship service, if it was under 2 hours, like, man, that's kind of weak tonight, huh? It's just what we did. We worship and we worship and we worship and we love to worship. I told you this morning, I said, be prepared tonight to pour out an offering upon the Lord Jesus. Be prepared to worship the Lord Jesus. Take advantage of those times where it's just extended worship. Worship for us is not about singing a song. I don't know if you noticed tonight or not. It really isn't about entertaining you. It's not about singing a cool song and giving you some contemplative lyrics for you to really, you know, meditate upon. It's simply a prayer of our heart set to music. It's simply a passion that is poured out that we're just expressing before the Father. So if you miss some of your opportunity tonight, well, I think we're going to worship a little bit more here. But if you missed it, learn from this. Don't stand there looking like checked out. My brother reminded me of the saying that we got, and it was from Gospel Bill. God's not dead and heaven burned down. Like, don't be bummed out, man. You serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is worthy of all praise. He is worthy of all worship. He is worthy of all honor. To lavishly, the point I was trying to get across this morning that I ministered to you, lavishly pour out your life upon Jesus. Do not waste your life pouring it out on all these other things. Just lavishly display with worship and shout and praise. Too many people have served a dead religion, a God that is a figment of their imagination. The reality of heaven has never struck their heart where they have seen what Jesus did for them. I've been bought, man. I've been redeemed. I was destined for death. I had the penalty of death upon me, eternal separation from God. And Jesus loved me so much, he said, no, I'm going to go save him. And when the reality of that strikes your soul, nothing's going to hold you back. Nothing's going to be able to steal your passion and your emotions, and you're not going to be too tired to worship God. You're not going to be so distracted by the bills and the family problems and all the other issues that is stealing away your passion from the Father. Get so sold out, get so all in the things game. That's probably, I mean, God, there's a number of things, obviously, that I fell in with Summer, but one of the very first things is I brought it to Pastor Mark. I said, what do you think about this girl? He said, she's all in. And I wanted to share just a little bit with her testimony, just her simple testimony, what took place. But I want you to be all in. Why straddle a fence? Have you ever straddled a fence? Look, I live on a ranch, and oftentimes I have to cross barbed wire. It's an extremely compromising situation to straddle barbed wire. I don't like it. I prefer to set up more gates. Why are you going to go through life walking down this fence of straddle? Dude, we beg you, don't. Just get all in. Sell out for the things of God. It is well worth it. Let him captivate your heart. It's a love relationship. He'll draw you in so close. Will you share just a little bit? Share your testimony.
On the way over here, Daniel just really quick asked, hey, would you like to share some of your testimony tonight? And I was like, okay, why not? I like sharing my testimony. And then I kind of laughed in my head and thought, I hope there's no religious people here because they won't like it very much. What I've found over the past almost 2 years now is whenever I share my testimony, it kind of bugs people and it makes them fidgety. And I like to watch some people and what they do when they react to my testimony, because mine is kind of unique in that it shouldn't be unique, but sadly it is today, because I jumped all into the kingdom of God. And that's, you know, something I thought was normal the first couple weeks I got saved. And Brittany was always encouraging me, saying, Summer, this is just, you know, all these people came up to me and said, this is just so awesome how you just jumped into the things of God. And some people it takes, you know, years to be able to come into the, you know, just start in the first level of maturity and then continue on from the first day to the second day to the third day. Some people stay in that for the first 10 years, 20 years, so I've heard. And so when I got saved, I said, Lord, I don't know what exactly is going on here. I don't know the Bible. You know, I'm kind of embarrassed that I've never even read, you know, several scriptures in the Bible at once. I only spot checked it when I was little. I got a Bible and somebody told me, oh, don't read it from, you know, cover to cover. That's not how you read it. And I was like, man, that's not what I'm hearing now. And so I jumped in and I said, Lord, I don't want to walk in my own way.
Yeah.
I don't want to walk in any way that I've been walking before. I want to see a difference because, you know, people saw me and I talked about this encounter with the Lord that I had, and they're like, okay, that's great, you know, good for you kind of thing. Like, it's probably going to be a phase, and don't get too excited about it because everyone encounters that. And it even bugged people, mainly religious people, when I said I got saved, that, you know, because not everybody believes the word of God, that it says we're born in sin and shaped iniquity. And when you get saved, you get a new heart and a new spirit. Mm-hmm. And you're redeemed by the blood of Jesus. And I believed that.
Yes.
And so anyways, the reason it bugs religious people is because I talk about the obedience that I stepped into with Jesus. And even in the church, you know, people get kind of like, oh, you know, yeah, I'm walking with Jesus, but and I like what, you know, what you've done with your life. But then they, once I start talking about, you know, yeah, it's just great to walk in the obedience of authority and just coming under the authority of a head leader in the church. It's so simple, guys. I mean, if you're not willing to just believe that the word of God is true, how are you going to believe somebody who's talking to you about Jesus and talking to you about something you need to get rid of or something that you need to, you know, increase in and the offense that can be rooted in a bitterness? It's just, it's not worth it. Jump into the things of God as if it were, you know, your first day being saved.
Yeah,
if you haven't experienced that from, you know, the day you called in the name of Jesus and the day you received a new heart and a new spirit, I just encourage you guys to jump into that.
Yeah.
Jump into the servitude. Jump into the complete abandonment of just offering everything you have to the Lord. It's amazing the messages we've been hearing about offerings. It's, Daniel and I were talking last night after church, you know, just about giving and how we're like, we haven't been giving enough. Wednesday night, we need to be giving more. And it was amazing how the Holy Spirit put that on both of our hearts. He put it on my heart in Washington and he put it also on his heart. But I kind of kept it in and I repented for that. And I said, okay. And then Daniel came to me with the same exact thing, like word for word. And I'm just like, thank you, Lord, for answering her. Because I went to prayer about it, said, Lord, you know, we need to move forward with this. And so he answered that. But anyways, just talking about money and giving and how if we're not willing to give our finances, if we're not willing to give, you know, everything that we have in terms of money, the means by which we live, how are we going to give our lives to Jesus? How are we going to give ourselves as a living sacrifice? Just something so small. If money to you guys is a big thing, don't give it. wait until you're willing to give your life. Well, because if you're not willing to give your life, you're gonna need your money, guys. So, anyways, just yes, coming under that authority is the best thing that could happen to you. And coming into the obedience of the fullness. How did Jesus learn obedience? By the things which he suffered. It's amazing to think about that. And it's amazing to think about the things that we suffer with. It can be like the silliest things. It's like, really, you're suffering because of that? But hey, Jesus, you know, he learned obedience to the things he suffered. And he was tempted with the same things we are. We can overcome that by the word of God and the truth and the goodness that the word has. And so, I know that, you know, a lot of you guys know my testimony, a very small part of it. There's only actually a few people who know, you know, a lot of the things that went along with it. But that's just the main thing that really, really gets to people. I get three main reactions when I share my testimony. And it's, one, people get angry and frustrated and don't want to hear it anymore because I talk about, I stopped sinning. I am no longer a sinner. I was washed in the blood. I don't need to do that anymore. Praise the Lord. Best day of my life. And the other reactions I get are people get encouraged, and that's usually the people who have a relationship, and also they get inspired. And so it's usually those three things. And so, you know, when you're sharing your testimony, you kind of check and see what reactions you're getting, because you should be getting those reactions. Yeah. If people are getting offended at your testimony, don't be surprised. They got offended at the best thing that was offered to them, and that's salvation by the blood of Jesus. Yeah. So get on fire for God. It's so worth it. He will increase the things in your life by 50,000%, by infinity percent. I mean, look what he did with me. It's, you know, people always come up to me and say, it's so amazing what, you know, God's done in your life. In a year, you got married, you found the man of your dreams. And I say, yeah, you know, that's great, but that should be happening with everybody, not finding the man of your dreams. But, you know, stepping into the blessings that God has for you. We don't need to be a people that's not blessed. We need to be a people who has this testimony of, hey, I started from here, and now I'm here. Look at what Jesus has done. Not, you know, I started it here, and now I'm struggling, trying to get along, and I'm barely here, but I want to be over there. When we were in Aberdeen, Washington, Pastor Debbie was just sharing some of her testimony about when she was in just a bad financial state, and she was kind of just getting super discouraged, and then the Holy Spirit spoke to her and said, you need to give your way out of this poverty.
Yeah.
She gave everything she had. It was amazing. Yeah. I thought about it. It was like, would we be willing to listen to that? That's pretty intense. To give your way out of poverty, to not even be able to drive your car down the road because it's, you know, a piece of trash, and you think, what do I even have to give? Yeah. The Lord wants to put in your heart the spirit of giving, such charity, such sharing of everything you have. Brittany is an amazing example of that. Yeah. When I got saved, I didn't have much. I was, you know, I was 18 years old, working. There was some stuff going on with my family, and I just didn't have much. And Brittany was willing to open up her home to me. She was willing to give so much, basically everything she had. She said, I see what God's doing in your life, and I'm so excited. I want to sow into that. Look at what she's done. Yeah. Look at what Jesus has done through her.
Yeah.
Not because she's anything special, I'm anything special. It's because she was an open vessel, willing to be used by Jesus.
That's it.
And so, you know, I'm not telling you guys you need to open your home and when you have a family that you need to take care of, but have that heart of giving and see what God is going to do. I mean, it's amazing. He has done the impossible in my life. He's given me the smallest things, you know, in my heart, every little detail that I'm like, oh, that'd be cool to have that one time in my life. That, you know, maybe later on once I have some money and I have a family, maybe we can like think about having a ranch. Boom, a year after I got saved, that was something hidden in my heart because I was born on a ranch. I love the mountains. Look where God happened to place me. It's so cool. When Daniel was talking about God saying, I'm gonna put Daniel Spitsbergen in this time and place right now. it was no coincidence. He has you guys in a very special place. Yes. Don't ever, you know, take that for granted. Don't ever kind of look past or beyond that as oh, you know, I'm not that big of a deal. I can't be used like that person got used. Guys, God wants to use you guys. Yes. like he used Paul, like he used all the apostles, and it doesn't stop in the book of Acts. It started there, and it's supposed to be continuing. It's supposed to be we're all in this together. We're all in this. We're all under the same authority. We're all listening to the one voice. We have one Father. We all need to be obeying that Father. And that starts with you know, having your house in order, your home in order, your family, your you know, being in the church. You got to be in order, or else it won't work. Right. Satan loves to make people ineffective in the kingdom of God. Yes. And if you're on fire on Sunday, you're okay. Yeah, I want to do things right. Or Wednesday night, and then the next day you're arguing with somebody on the phone. Hey, that's disobeying God. Yeah. That's, you know, you may not be directly disobeying a pastor or somebody. You're disobeying somebody even bigger and more important. Right. He wants to get in every crack and crevice of your life and set you right, set you straight, to the point of, if you have that temptation of being discouraged, because discouragement is of the devil, yeah. That's not something we should have in our lives. It is, we don't want anything that's of the devil in our life. Amen. If you have that in your life, get rid of it. Amen. And if you are feeling tempted to be discouraged, that you're ineffective, that is a stinking lie. Amen. You get running on your feet. You guys jump those hurdles one at a time. Don't get overwhelmed. Yeah. You guys become more than conquerors. Yeah. And me too, I'm preaching to myself here. Leaps and bounds, glory to glory. Thank you, Father, that you increase us.
Yes.
Thank you, Holy Spirit. Yeah. You lead us and you guide us. So, yes, that was what I wanted to share. The long and short of my testimony was just that I stepped out of the disobedience. Actually, I was obeying sin and I was obeying iniquity, and then I stepped over to obeying the Father. That's, and that's that was the best decision, yeah, I could have ever made. So thanks.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. The simplicity of simply hearing the word and responding to the word and coming under the rulership of Christ. I hear many people say, well, I'm just so afraid of being controlled, and I'm just so fearful that I will be manipulated. Good grief. Are you afraid of being desperately in love? Are you afraid of being so overwhelmed with joy and peace and goodness? Are you really afraid of just feeling the best you've ever felt? Come on. God is not calling us to anything that is scary. It is wonderful and it is good, but He demands the obedience. Summer is probably, she's runner-up to you. I think she's close. In the Word, I mean, my mom consumes the Word and lives the Word and eats the Word like very few people I've ever met. Summer lives in the Word. It is a testimony. It is an example. It is provoking to me. And it is something that she's got a hold of that's a secret that really shouldn't be a secret. A desperate hunger for the Word to just consume it. Daily giving yourself to this. Why is it that so many have sat under intense, powerful, incredible teaching, but there's been very little growth? The sad reality has been a lack of response. Look, when you're in a bad situation, some had some rough things going on. There were some bad situations. When you're in a bad situation, it's easy to say, I am done with that. I'm getting all in on the good. You want to get desperate to get all in on the good and stay there. There's many things that some are touched on that I'm not even going to revisit, because it's about the offering. So I want everybody to stand with me right now and prepare an offering. Because as I minister to you this morning, there is that direct correlation. Look, you can only go as far as that faith that God has stirred in your heart can take you. God's not going to ask you to go beyond your means. He's not going to ask you to do something that you're not ready for. But He's going to work on you. He's going to be patient. He's going to draw you with cords of loving kindness and tender mercy. He's going to say, I want every bit. I want it all. I want it all. Come and worship Him. We have many things to finance. Look, we're financing the local church. We're doing church plants. We're financing ministry throughout the United States of America. And we're financing those things that are taking place overseas. Mass evangelism crusades, establishing orphanage, to be able to go in to preach the gospel to people that have never heard. That is our heart. The unreached people groups. It takes money to finance these things. And you have to participate. Because as much as I know and believe that God has put me in this time, in this place, He's put you in it. Don't be wasted potential. Do not waste your life on those things that will have no significance. Be sold out for the kingdom. Be passionate about the things of the kingdom. Lavishly display your love for the Father through your life, through your giving, through who you are. Just shining forth with the glory of heaven. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. I hope nobody's in a hurry tonight. Pastor Mark's on his way, and I guarantee he's got lots to say. Here's what irritates me. Here's what irritates me. I have seen people go to stupid concerts, right? I mean, stupid concerts. They will wait 2 or 3 hours for the main event to show up, right? They'll stand there. They pay ridiculous amounts of money for the entrance tickets, and then they stand there and they wait for hours on end for the big hit celebrity to show up late. I think God's worth waiting on a little bit, right? Why don't we learn to be hungry for the things of God? Why don't we just go ahead and linger in the house of God for a little while? Is it really that important to get home to like make yourself up a little snack and turn on the TV? I mean, what are you going to do when you get home, right? Why are you in such a hurry to go home? What is it that you've got planned, like big plans? Let me give you a little insight and a tip and a rule you should live by. Don't make plans on Sunday. Just don't do it, right? If you get around to eating, good. You can plan maybe to eat. But if that doesn't work out, don't just have one day. Maybe you can fast one meal or two meals, right? Set aside Sunday for the Lord. Set aside a time in your life that is consecrated to God, because God wants our everything. Look, I get provoked when I hear Pastor Mark talk about people that give 50% of their paychecks and people that are able to live off of 90, you know, give 99%, live off of 1% of their income. I get provoked about that. I'm saying, my goodness, I'm behind. I can't do that right now. I don't have the means, but I have somewhere I can start. I've got a goal, and we set new goals here. We said, all right, this is where we're at, and this is what we can do. We can double up. We can take it to the next level, and we can have a plan to get there. Because if you sit in that place of, well, I can't do that, that's crazy, to give 50% to God, or to have 99% of your income going to the kingdom, that's completely, no one would even fathom that. That's like, no, you're crazy. Well, if you think that that's crazy, fine. You're not ever going to step into a blessing. We're going to get there. And God's going to give us the wisdom to go step by step. It's a walk of faith. He's not going to ask us to go beyond what it is that we can handle and that those things that he's developed and matured in our lives to understand. But he is going to ask us to go forward. Because if you're not progressing, if you're not maturing daily, if there isn't some upward movement, what are you doing? So you have to ask yourself this. Where is it that I'm able to step forward? Where is it that I'm able to see growth? Where is it that I'm able to mature. Are you with me? I know you guys are hungry for this. I want you to get this, because we've been too easily satisfied with kicking back and saying, it's comfortable here. I'm okay here. You're not okay. Because if the things of the kingdom do not consume your every passion, your every waking moment, something else has your affections and it's going to pull you away. I promise you, it will pull you away. And you don't want that to happen. Sell out. Get all in. Get 100% all in. Dive head first into the things of God and watch what God will do with you. There's nothing special about anybody that you can look at that has risen and is proclaiming the message and carrying the torch and the fires of revival. You can ask, what is it that's special about them? Usually one common denominator. They were desperately hungry for God above all else. They could not live without the anointing. They could not live without the fire of the Holy Ghost. And they just went all in. Is it hard? No, it's really not that hard. Are there challenges? Are there things that you have to confront, breakthrough? Yes. But God says, come. My burden is easy, right? My yoke, it's light. He's inviting us in. Respond. Respond with your heart. Respond with your finances and your offering and your praise and your worship. Every time you have the opportunity to lavish your passion upon the things of God, upon the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, do it, and do it with all your heart and your might and your strength. In Jesus' mighty name, I want you to come and give. The Lord is going to bless and multiply these finances, these things that are sown. Father, I thank you that every person in here that is giving, that there be great multiplication. Oh, Father, that you would bring a blessing, pour out a blessing. Oh, Father, so that we would receive it and be a blessing to others, that we would finance these things of the kingdom. In the name of Jesus. Oh.
Your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. Your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. Your presence is like a fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. So sweet. So sweet to my soul, so sweet, so sweet to my soul. Your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. Your presence, it's like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. Your presence, it's like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. So sweet to my soul, so sweet. Sweet to my soul. Lord, your word is like a fire burning me. Lord, your word is like a fire burning me. A consuming fire burning me. A consuming fire. Burn in me. Oh, boom, boom, in my soul. 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 Boom, 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 boom. Your word is like a fire burning me. Lord, your word is like a fire burning me. A consuming fire burning me. A consuming fire burning me. Oh, boom, boom, boom. In my soul, boom, boom, burn. In my soul, boom, boom, burn. In my soul, boom, boom, burn. In my soul, your fire. You are all my heart's desire. You are all my heart's desire. You are all my heart's desire. But you are all my heart's desire. Only you, Lord. You are. heart's desire. Lord, you are all our heart's desire. Lord, you are all our heart's desire. Lord, you are all our heart's desire. And we worship with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind and strength, oh God. People of God, and you are. And forever we will sing of all your good. Forever we will sing of all your mercy. Forever we will sing of all your goodness. Forever we will sing of your tender mercy, Lord. Forever we will sing of all your good. Ever will we sing of your tender mercy, Lord. Great is thou. Forever we will say, oh, great is thou. Oh, great is thou. Oh, great is thou. What great things he has done. What great things you have done for us. Oh, great is thou. Oh, great is thou. Oh, great is thou. Oh, great is thou. Great is thou. Great is thou. Great is thou. Greatly to be is better than life. I live my life as a living sacrifice. Oh, because your loving kindness is better than life. I live my life as a living sacrifice. Because your loving kindness is better than my soul will praise you, my soul will Holy, 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 holy is the Lord.
Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for the abiding place. Hallelujah. One of the best churches on the planet. You can be seated. Thank you, mighty God. I thought I was going to get in earlier. I had no idea I was going to have to get on an airplane, fly 6 hours. I thought it was going to be a little bit, well, it's actually closer to 7 hours. But praise God. I mean, we saw the power of God touch New London while we were there. And I'm so blessed at all the things and all the reports that I've heard, just, you know, how many people were just giving themselves this morning and this past weekend to build in the local church. That's what we're doing. That's what God's commissioned us to do. He's commissioned us to build a local church. And in that, that's right here in San Diego. And you know, the Lord's given us a wonderful job of it. And then we've been at it for a long time and seen points in time where there's been huge numbers of people and it's shrink down and we've moved around a lot. We've done a lot of different things. People just get exhausted keeping up with this. But I'm going to tell you, listen, Father's given us the ability to conquer the world without any ambition, just obeying Him and just having a good time of it as well, you know, and planting churches and building churches. Of course, you know, we have, and we're so thankful for every one of you who reached into the realms of faith and participated with us in getting this building paid off. And so the first part of that's done, so we have enough money to give the guys the finances that they need when they drop it off this Friday. And we have enough money to put the foundation in. So I think we have something around $54,000, $55,000. And so that'll pay for getting the building on the ground, getting the foundation in, and we'll just work at getting it up. And then Daniel and Sumi going to pastor the church, and they got a good pastoral staff around them. They've got Brad and Margaret and Mike, and the Lord's building that. And we're just going to see many people come into the kingdom. James and I were just talking about what we're going to do in Klamath Falls this next year, and just go out into the streets, start reaching people, start talking to people about their souls, start telling them what they were doing last night and last week, and tell them what God wants to do with them from here on in. And it kind of shocks people when you've stepped into enough communication with the Lord that as soon as you meet someone, you know what's going on in their life, only because, you know, God knows what's going on in everybody's life. And it's a wonderful thing when we step into a communication with the Holy Ghost where we're allowed to start knowing some of the things that He knows. And it's only for the purposes of unlocking the hearts so that they can understand how much God loves them. Hey, what a blessing. If there's anything that I want to encourage God's people to do is to throw themselves completely into the work of the ministry, because when you do, that really is participating with what Christ Jesus has called us to do. He said, if we'll lose our life, we can have His. Hallelujah. It was a good trade. If you lose your life, you'll find it. And it's not just finding something that you had or something that pertains to a human existence, because, of course, the context is having His life. Amen. And, wow, He's brought us His eternal life, which is the very life of God, the very life of the Spirit. We want you to understand this, you're evil. Papa hasn't given us some kind of a religious thing. And the world needs to see it, because really, Satan's working overtime to turn the church into looking like a bunch of buffoons. Right. You know, he works overtime to really just make it to where that which represents Him is just so out there that it just has no significance, no meaning, no relevance to the hunger that is in the hearts of people everywhere. People are sitting on the edge of their seats right now, waiting to see the power of God revealed. It's like never before. I was just sitting beside someone for 6 hours, and of course you can't sit beside me for 6 hours and either get saved or hate me. I mean, so, you know, praise God. This guy, his name's John Teal, and he's coming to church. And, you know, Father's given me a lot of patience for people all wrapped up in Eastern religions. You can't hardly blame them. I mean, we haven't been doing what we need to be doing. So I'm just very, very patient with all of that. And, you know, I let them use their semantics, and I use it for my, I take their semantics, and I use it for my message. Hallelujah. And I get them with their semantics and all their positive and negative and this and that, and I get them right over to who the positive is, Christ Jesus, who the door into the way, the door, the truth, the way, the life is, Christ Jesus, to be able to step right on into the presence of the Father, to live out this abundant life that not everybody's showing, because it's joy unspeakable, yes, and full of glory. I mean, come on. We say that Jesus is the doorway into the realms of heaven, and we look like, my goodness, is that heaven? That looks like the other place. For so many people, it doesn't. They haven't stepped in understanding how to connect with the Holy Spirit, to move in the peace that passes understanding, to just live there. They're so living in the self-interest. And I am dedicated to getting people out of that selfish realm where it's all about you, and your life is a blessing, and it's heavenly so long as everything's going your way and you got milk in the refrigerator and gas in your tank and your little toys and nobody messed with your stuff. Everything's in the right place in right order. And everybody praised you according to your mindset of the kind of interaction you feel everybody should have with you. No one spoke bad about you. No one cut you off on the highway. And by the way, if they do, you're quickly overcome by that, whatever's going on in their life. And Father wants to move us out of that into a place where we begin to set the tone of the atmosphere. God's given us the ability to create the atmosphere of heaven. Everywhere we go, people are constantly making choices, heaven or hell, constantly going on. Father's given us His Word, hallelujah. People need to start living by it like never before, living by the Word, speaking the Word. And He's given us the Holy Spirit to manifest the Word, to manifest and reveal Jesus in our life. He wants to rule over us at the very core of our existence. And oh, what wonderful thing it is when all of a sudden we've learned the joys of denying ourselves so we can live in Him. Amen. I'm telling you, yourself is a bunch of baggage, too much for you to bear, and it's too much for us to. I mean, it's, come on, man. I mean, Father, you know, you look at the life of Jesus. I love this, looking, studying the life of Jesus. For 30 years, He walked out alive, showing us what it means to be saved. Not baptized in the Holy Ghost, just what it means to be saved. What it means to just walk with the Father. What it means to just, you know, love righteousness and hate iniquity. And nobody knew who He was, because He wasn't running around, you know, just saying, hey, God, can you keep a secret? You know who I am? He didn't need all that. I mean, that's all that self stuff. We so insecure. We got to always have everybody, you know, constantly congratulating us and, you know, constantly trying to, you know, inform them who we are and what we've done. And it didn't amount to nothing. Jesus just walked it out. You can just see Him living out a life of lowliness and meekness and serving people and kindness. He's the guy who's happy every day. He's the guy who's just always got just a good thing to say. He's just, you know, full of love. He's always in the church meeting. Come on now. Just imagine Jesus for 30 years. Right. For 30 years. And one day the power of God comes upon Him and He gets in real trouble. Huh? Because now He's going to show heaven. And as soon as you start showing heaven, people aren't so feeling so good about themselves no more. Yeah. And now they go, uh-oh, what's this? This is heaven. Well, I had it all figured out. I had it all ironed out. I had everything all set so I could feel better about myself. And now you're showing this glory. And I'm thinking, man, I haven't even begun. You know, I think one of the saddest verses of Scripture is John 3:19. Jesus said, men love darkness rather than light. And he says, this is the condemnation. It's not God's condemnation against men. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Here's the condemnation against men, that men love darkness rather than light because they love sin and iniquity. I mean, I'll never be able to fully get my head wrapped around this in any way. And I certainly don't want to get my heart wrapped around it. That after men have been able to live, this is man, and this is a landscape of humanity, and I want to make sure none of it's in me.
Yeah.
Are you listening to me? The landscape of humanity is after living with Christ Jesus for 1,000 years, living with God, living in the glory of God, where there is no death, where there is no pain, where there is no sorrow, where there is no poison, the curse is removed, Satan is bound for 1,000 years. All mankind, the nations of the earth, are living with Christ Jesus, the resurrected saints, living with angels, cherubim, Zoah, seraphim, and all the rest. I mean, it's just this glorious interaction of heaven, all that is in heaven, all is around the throne of God. And I'm sure that, I mean, it goes beyond all of that. It's everything that it would be conceptual to be in a situation that we could imagine, to be in a situation where God and man are living together, and Father has done something that has caused the earth to blossom like a rose after all the devastation. It defies the imagination of how beautiful, how wonderful, how glorious, how splendorous it will be. And yet at the end of the 1,000 years, the scripture says, when Satan is loose for a little season, men will come and flock unto him as the sand of the sea. Yeah. I cannot even imagine that. That men would rather do evil after all of that. That's been restrained. They've not allowed to do any kind of iniquity. They've not been allowed to participate with any kind of evil, with any kind of sin for 1,000 years. It's just been glory divine. It's been joy every day. It's been goodness every day. It's been like the greatest Holy Ghost meeting you've ever been in every day. And then at the end of the 1,000 years, men went to flock to God, flock to the realms of Satan and leave the presence of God. And not only that, but will actually come up against God to try to kill him and destroy him at the end of it. That would be the finality of it. Every bit of sin, every bit of rebellion, every bit of ungodliness will come to a final end. That will be Satan's fifth judgment. It will come to a final end at that day. It'll be it. All rebellion will be gathered together in one place. There will be no more beings left. You know, somebody said, why did God allow sin to continue? I really believe that God allowed sin to continue because of this one reason. He wanted to show all creation that the smallest little bit of disobedience would ultimately blossom and result into people not even wanting God to exist. Wanting him to be destroyed, wanting him to be wiped out. And I mean, if there's ever anything that should explode in our life, it's that, to recognize that every bit of it is death. Every bit of it is destruction. Every bit of it is the enemy of God's life, God's goodness. Man, if there's anything God's people have got to do is they got to stand up and quit being so led about their own whims and their own will and their own wishes and their own things. And just understand how to throw in with God, because, you know, we thus judge that if one died for all, every one of us are dead. That we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves. God gave, you know, every one of us have actually been translated and we didn't even know it. Because the Lord translated us back, as it were, in a moment, something that we're not even conscious of in many respects, where we were crucified with Christ Jesus, where we were buried with him by baptism into his death. We were raised up together with him and alive together with him right now and seated with him in a heavenly realm. We don't have to live all of this crazy life and tension that the culture imposes upon us. I'll never forget, we were out in the backwoods of Australia. We were in a place called the Pitjantjatjaras. Hall's Creek, actually, and there were people that come in from all the various different places of Australia, the backwoods, and they were just barefooted. They were just Aborigines and native Australians. And there's, you know, the women were just dancing around saying, great things, God is doing great things. They didn't need all the stuff you need. Barefooted kangaroo, little kangaroo to eat, you know. And we had gas to get here and, you know, get gas to get back to the little lean-to. And they're just caught away in the goodness of God. If you had that, you'd be walking around feeling like Job. Oh, God, why have you forsaken? Because culture has imposed all kinds of desires that are not even meaningful. They have no value. God's just looking for you and I to let go of our lives so he can give us something that goes far beyond anything we've ever could have possibly dreamed of having. His life. And we want God to do it like this. We want God to give us a little bit of that time while we hold on to what we can trust in, while we hold on to what we're comfortable with, while we hold on to those things that are important to us. The Lord just looking at us, and he's not saying anything different to us than he said to the rich man, you know, who just simply said, just forsake everything. He just says, just take all that you have, give it to the, go sell it, go give it to the poor, and you can have treasure in heaven. Come get in the riches and come and follow me. Huh? It would have been that rich man would have stepped into the real riches that go far beyond. No, our culture has taught us, and the spiritual realms of our culture, which is governed by and run by the prince of the power of the air, how to hang on to our life, how to have and lust for more, how to be so wrapped up and consumed with ourselves that if somebody takes our chair at church, we're mad. If somebody takes our parking place, we can't believe that we could be so insulted and so disrespected. If some, you know, person who's lost doesn't know God cuts us off on Monday morning on I-5, we come under that thing to where and that's why we constantly encourage you, take all that you have, throw it into the kingdom. Go ahead, agree with God that if one died for all, then we were all dead, that we're all dead. We were crucified with him, not being crucified with him. It happened. We're buried with him, and we're raised up together. And you don't get to be raised up until you're crucified, till you die. You don't get to be raised up. So all these people saying they're dying and they're trying to die, they're not living the resurrected life. You need to get on with that, because that's pretty idiot. It's aggravating us at this point. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we want you to get raised up. That's a born-again experience. Yes. That's a new life in Jesus. That's being filled with the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. New heart, new spirit, Holy Ghost on inside of us. Then God comes along and baptizes in the Holy Ghost so we can show heaven even on a grander scale. Amen. To where we take responsibility for everybody that's out there and sick and diseased. And, you know, I was telling some people the other day, I said, just go down there to that project. They were telling me about the poor area. I said, just go down to the projects and just go find the roughest kids and love on them. And go down there and just search around, see, knock on doors, see if anybody's sick inside. Just say, you're the sick police. You're the disease busters. You come to help any way they need help. And you come in the authority, in the name of Christ Jesus to bring the gospel of the kingdom into their house. My goodness, it's hard. You're never going to really run into too many poor people that are going to get their gun out and run you off. Love is a wonderful thing. If there's anything I want to do better than I've ever done, I want to do more of it. I want to love better, okay? Yeah. Love will liberate you from your fear. Yeah. Love will liberate you from your shame, your condemnation. Hallelujah. Love, I'm going to tell you, it'll conquer everything. I mean, when there's no fear there, you're just standing there looking at some, you know, people who would otherwise kill you, and they're just captivated by your love. It seems to me like the people that are more evil than others are more impacted by love, because it takes them back. Yeah. You're standing there just looking at them with love in their eyes while they're telling you with all their threats and all their hate language what they're going to do. you know, and you're just standing there saying, there's no fear, you know. You're just standing there, maybe not even saying that. There's been times where I've looked at gang members. They're just standing there doing all their things, starting to do their break dance, like, you know, where they're getting ready to hit you just before, you know, at some point in it, you know, and you don't know where they're going to hit you from. And you just stand there just looking at them, just captivated by the anointing of the Holy Ghost, not even, hardly even noticing them, just captivated by God. Having our affection so seated on heaven, looking unto the author and finisher of our faith, where it becomes something more than just religious ideas and religious concepts and biblical scriptures that you understand, but where you become overwhelmed with God. Yeah. Hallelujah. I'm talking about this is the real deal, okay? This is the place where all of a sudden, you know, self isn't important anymore. And, you know, the Lord gives us some, He gives us some very clear instruction on how to do that. Praise God. And I just so desperate to see God's people step in this so that we can live all day joy with joy unspeakable. I love the one verse of scripture in Thessalonians where the Lord just simply says, rejoice evermore. Always be exceedingly joyful for the rest of all eternity. Okay, I empower you. That's God empowering us. People said, oh, you know, the Lord said, be holy even as He's holy. Like they've got some huge obligation, responsibility. This is a heavy burden to carry. No, the Lord empowers us with His word. Amen. He says, be. Yeah. He said, light be and light was. That is a direct, literal translation of the Hebrew language, okay? Light be and light was. He says, be holy. Amen. And we get to be holy. Amen. You know, all we have to do is want to be this, but we can't hang on to our own life and have His. Because he wants to bring us out of the earthly into the heavenly. He wants to bring us out of the condition of the human into the divine. That's what He did. He made us one with Him. He gave us the divine nature. He made us a new creation. He made us a new creature. But you got to stop acting like an old one to be a new one. Come on, man. You can't be a new one, go back and start and continue on with the old life and the old way with the same behavior and the same mindset and the same attitudes and, you know, the same squirrel-like, priorities. Now that we've been given this heavenly life. Hallelujah. Let us judge that if one died for all are dead, that we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves, but to embrace what He's given to us, to embrace His identity, embrace His empowerment. Father's the husbandman. Christ Jesus is the vine. We are the branches. We're dwelling in Him. His life is manifested. The vine's life is manifested through the branch. The interdependency that has been given to the branch and the vine, it's just so beautiful. This is God's divine design for you and me, and all we have to do is submit to it. We don't have to try to make it happen. We don't have to try to work towards it. All we got to do is cooperate with it, because there are spiritual laws. So many people fail to recognize the spiritual laws of life that are in Christ Jesus, which have made us free from the laws of sin and death. My. You know, you can just imagine, you get up every morning and you can just do what Ephesians chapter 3 says, and you can bow your knee to the Father of all the families in heaven and earth. You can bow your knee to Him. And you can begin to make a petition towards Him. You can find yourself giving your life over to a divine interaction of just sitting there meditating on His presence, asking Him to reveal to you the things that He knows, meditating on His Word, just giving yourself, I love just giving myself to the Word of God. Because what happens is I learn how to hear God speak. Have you ever just gone along reading Genesis 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, then all of a sudden a verse of Scripture stands out to you? Yeah. Just captivates you? That's learning how to hear God speak to you. That wasn't because of your curiosity was sparked. That's because God, the Holy Ghost, grabbed a hold of you and said, I'm going to train you how to hear me. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. I mean, if people would just do that every day. Yeah. You step into the word of wisdom. You step into the word of knowledge. You step into the discerning of spirits. It's just all just so easy. We're so distracted, so preoccupied. Those of you who are given, You know, God's given you jobs to make finances. Don't get all wrapped up in trying to get strained so hard to make finances. God wants to do something supernatural for you. And I'm telling you, I'm commanding a blessing on your finances. I know that many of you have sacrificially given. You reached in, you heaved ho on this one, you know, to build this building. I'm going to tell you, there is going to be so many great things happening. I mean, the camp meetings that are going to be out there, the gatherings of ministers from all over the United States that has already been planned by other ministries, not even by me. I mean, they're spearheading it, you know, that are going to be out there, the many things that are going to be out there. And I'm going to tell you, that is a letting go of your own interest, because you could think about, well, I could get this for myself, I could get that for myself, because we're always bringing it back to ourselves. What about me? You know? But when we make it all about Him, when we make it all about Him, oh, I got some more money. I got an offering. I was left it in a backpack. Go get my backpack, because make sure that get the offering in the offering basket. Because I was at a place, they gave me an offering, and I have them right out to the church, and so it gets to be, I get to be, at least to get to hold it and put it in the offering basket. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Because Father wants to bless us, and He wants to multiply everything about our life, but He can't do it so long as we're hanging on to it. Because one of the fundamental things is we've got to quit trusting ourselves. Yeah. We've got to leave the places of our security and that which is familiar to us before we're going to ever step into the inheritance of God. Over and over and over again, I could give example after example, but there's no one that stands out like Abraham. And we're just going to have to be willing to understand there's all of these very clear declarations of God's spiritual laws of what He's telling us to do, and then He gives us all these examples too. It's unmistakable. Whether we want to cooperate or not, God has made a way for us to live in heaven today. God has made a way for us to step into all the full display of His life and godliness. God has made a way. He's called us to His glory and His purity. God has made a way. And if the church doesn't stand up and start loving this realm, darkness will overwhelm everything in every place. It will become such an impact that Satan has upon the minds of men in his deceptive power that they won't be able to retain the knowledge of God. But if we'll shine, if we'll rise and shine. And the only way we're going to do it is, once again, it's every part of our being just being released to Him. He's going to take it and multiply it. God will multiply your finances the way He multiplied the life, your human life that you surrendered. Hallelujah. Here's, bring it to me, to Him, and what He give you with it. Twice your life? No. Three times your life? No. Huh? Four times your life? Praise God for the family. Everybody's in the ministry. Praise God. That don't happen by accident. People don't understand it. They think, well, I just got lucky. I just got lucky. All my children full of the Holy Ghost and in the ministry. I just got lucky. That's men. That's what they do. They don't really think about, wait a minute, God's got models. God's got examples. God not only shows it in His Word, declares it to us in His Word by commands, shows it by models, but gives us examples around us as well. And praise God. Thank you, Father, for the privilege of being able to give. Hallelujah. I mean, just think about it, dear people. God wants to take our lives and use us to bring forth such a display of the power of God in heaven on earth that nobody can deny it. They might reject it, but they cannot deny it. Father wants to resource us with the divine ability to do His works and greater works, and it ain't going to happen so long as we're playing around with mediocrity and religion. Breakthrough to relationship, because literally the masses are sitting on the edge of their seat waiting to see Jesus. And God's made a way to where that in exchange for our life, we get the life of Jesus. Praise God. And you know what? That's going to be some self-control. It is. And that's why self-control is one of the fruits of the Spirit. So He's given to us like rivers. Hallelujah. Yeah, hallelujah. Praise God. You know, I went into the bagel shop to get somebody a bagel the other day while I was in New London. and the bagels smelled real good. But I had to remind myself, I've already eaten breakfast. Huh? And you can't have one. Somebody said, does it ever end? No, it never ends. Huh? It never ends. Saying no to things that are excess, things that you don't need, things that are wrong, things that didn't come as full-blown sin and temptation. We belong to God. I mean, Father's made us stewards over His house. My, what wonderful thing it would be if all of a sudden you don't allow yourself to be all frowny and snotty anymore. Huh? And grouchy and grumpy no more. Not to anyone, especially your spouse. Huh? Especially husbands. You know, that isn't even a part of your life anymore. Huh? Because you've handed yourself over to Jesus. And what happens is if you will, the multiplication of this, the growth and the maturation of it is, be like rivers busting out of you. You can't contain it. Yeah. Laughter, joy, love, grace, kindness, goodness. It'll be busted like fire shut up on the inside of your bones, busting out of you. Come on, people. This is where all the goodness is. This is where the life of Jesus Christ is what we're called to live. Go read about it. That's what God has empowered us to live. The things that you hold on to in your own self-interest keep you from living it. It's not even the demon powers. It's not even demon spirits. Because Father has made a way to where they have no power over any of us. We draw a bloodline. They can't cross over the bloodline to us. We can cross over to them. But they can't cross over to us. We give ourselves to this abundant life. We give ourselves to this glory. We give ourselves to this godliness. We give ourselves to this purpose.
Yes.
And I was raised in this, and I didn't understand it as a little guy, but you know, I understand it a whole lot better now in that constant commitment to say everything about our life, everything about our time, everything about our finances is going into the kingdom. And many of God's people have that, but they didn't really understand how to let God bless them and how to move in faith for the multiplication to say, okay, now we can step out and finance the crusade in Kashmir. Somebody said, how did you get to Kashmir? I went, who invited you to Kashmir? I said, Jesus. And the Holy Ghost sent the invitation too, because there's no, the church is in hiding. But oh, what we're going to do. See, we got new plans. We have to think entirely different from Kashmir now. Because there are no churches. So we're going to have a massive evangelism crusade. In Nepal, at least there was a network of churches because they've been evangelizing in Nepal since 1952. People have been going to jail, openly evangelizing, and you knew where the churches were. But it's not that way in Kashmir. And so we get a whole new level of thinking, a whole new level of faith realm. You think I'm going to slow down just because I don't know where to send the people to church? Give me a break, man. We're at the cricket stadium, and until we get some churches put together, we'll just keep having a meeting in the cricket stadium. We'll just keep just doing that once a week. But Father will work it all out. He just got it all under control. You people think you got to think it all out. You think it all out, and you paralyzed. Paralyzed. God don't need our pea brain. And that's really what it is. It's just little old teeny little thing, you know, barely can even open up our eyes and close them when we need them. Huh? Get a few little thoughts going, we think we're brilliant. I mean, my goodness, he just wants us to be led by the Holy Ghost. Let's just look at it. Enoch got to walk with God. You and I, we get to walk in the Spirit. Oh, should there be men and women of honor and integrity that will say, the life you gave to me, I fully desire to live it. If you can die for me, surely I can die for you. If you can live for me, surely I can live for you. If you can go and suffer as the sin offering, sure, I can go ahead and live in this righteousness of God. Oh, dear people, Father's just looking for it, and as we with abandonment obey Him, move forward with Him in the faith, not orthodoxy, just because we know how to quote scriptures and we know what good doctrine is versus what bad doctrine is, but we live it. It's an orthopraxy. We live it. We want to live the Word. We're doers of the Word, not just hearers of the Word. We do it. Yeah. You know, over and again, I tell people, if you would just live Matthew 5, 6, and 7, your entire life would be changed. And first thing you would discover is how you need to depend upon the Holy Ghost. First thing you discover is that you can't live a life of self-absorption, self-interest, all the things that you want to do in all of your leisure time, Southern California, all the things you're doing to exercise your little bodies so you can stay fit and in shape. Give me a break. Come on. God wants to do something so much bigger with their life. Amen. And it's just such a blessing as I watch people just begin to let go. Huh? Amen. Come on. Amen. As I watch people like Sandy go ahead and just empty out her bank account to get 293 backpacks and fill them with stuff to bless people at the, you know, at little community, and you do that 1,000 times. It needs to be done by everybody in this place. And every God will give you creative things to do. Highest happy living. Highest addictive living in it. Go gather up souls. Go gather up 11:13 this morning, whatever it was. Come on. Yep. Put a big metallic sign on your car that says taxi cab to heaven. Hallelujah. Get your car into the kingdom of God and you'll have a payment for God instead of for you. Come on. I mean, you get to clean up your car in terms of taking care of reaching the lost instead of cleaning up your car and taking care of the stuff that you've done. I mean, if we just do this, this is life. Jesus showed us how everybody, everyone in this gospel died for the kingdom. Jesus died. Peter died, James died, even Thomas died. Everybody died as a martyr, as a martyr. But we want to hang on our life. We don't risk too much. You don't get to live big. You don't get to live big. I mean, John, you know, they tried to boil him in oil. He just wouldn't boil. I figure God, you know, that's tradition. But I figure that's what tradition says. I don't have any reason to doubt it. But, you know, I figure God didn't let him get scarred up or anything. Can you imagine getting boiled in oil? That'd leave you horrific looking. You'd wish you had he's gone ahead and been a martyr. You did everything but get to leave the body. But at any rate, then the exile on the Isle of Patmos. This is the church, dear people. I was just up there in Boston, in Providence, Rhode Island. Providence, Rhode Island, and Newport, they have a place, this is radical, I just discovered this, where Mary Dyer, one of my ancestors, one of my relatives, and Anne Hutchinson, on the day of Pentecost, 1638, were praying, and a 7.0 earthquake on the Richter scale took place. That's what they estimated, 6.8 to 7.0, on the day of Pentecost, literally. 50 days from the Passover that year. They were praying, and their prayer was, Lord, empower us with the signs and wonders of the early church to reach the lost in Boston, to shake the powers of religion that are holding us in prison. They thought that it was the same as Pentecost. Wouldn't you? I do that. I believe too. There's a lot of it's recorded by various different, recorded by the governor of Massachusetts, Boston, Massachusetts, recorded by the actual preacher over that whole area, Winthrop. The thing about it is, dear people, these people died for the gospel. Yeah. They died. It was their blood that produced the United States of America. True. Go read about it. Go read about their offering that broke the yoke of the Puritans no longer being allowed to have a theocratic rule in the colonies of America. They died. They gave their blood. You know, when they got these monuments where they were actually having this prayer meeting. And Mary Dyer says, I've had a glimpse of paradise. I'm not turning back for you. They're saying, oh, if you just make these compromises, I'll not make any compromises, though I enjoy health, a wonderful family, and great prosperity. I'm pouring it all upon this altar of sacrifice. Wow. Come on, people. Can we have some of God's people like that?
Yes.
Do you have to be born in China to be like this? No. Do you have to be born in some foreign nation, you know, to be willing to give your whole life over to the kingdom? Oh, my. We get to live great, people. We get to live big for God, people. Get out of your stinking, smelly, death-ridden lust. Hallelujah. Get over here in this place and be clothed with the majesty of Christ Jesus. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Make no provision for your own interest. Wake up in the morning. We're going to get up in the morning and we're going to head out to the ranch to get everything squared away for what we're doing with the church and to begin to get some more progress towards what we have a vision to do in terms of seeing, you know, the orphans by the hundreds of thousands and then by the millions reach for the kingdom through the things of God, the ideas that God has given to us that He's shaping. Because we're not only going to grow the local church, we're not only going to lay down our life and die and give everything that we have to grow the local church, but we're also going to plant churches. We're going to give our life and our energy as the Lord just continually throws open these doors. And believe me, they are just right, left, and center opening to go and evangelize churches because people are hungry to be shaken by the power of God. They need to be challenged. They're hungry to see signs and wonders and miracles. Ah, they're hungry to hear heaven's cry again that stirs their soul. Hallelujah. That causes them to rise to greatness instead of living in the prison of mediocrity and religion. We're not going to stop there. Hallelujah. Mission field is calling. We're going to see God use us to raise up more missionaries to go to the foreign field than at any other time over the next, you know, couple of decades, and whoo, Masata Rene, and not stop there because we're going to do and continue to do the mass evangelism crusades. And I just praise God for what He's doing with Fidel Castro right now and Raul as He gets them all ready. And I'm all checked out on the security thing so I can walk in there and lead them into the kingdom. Hallelujah. They're going to pay, you know, they're going to pay. They're paying for the crusade in Havana. Hallelujah. Ha, ha, ha. They're 75,000 seater, their choice premier place for playing baseball. Hallelujah. It's going to become the stadium of Jesus Christ, of our God and of His kingdom. And they're going to pay for the whole thing. Praise God. Hallelujah. Ha, ha. Come on, lose your life. Whatever you're doing, resign. Come follow us. We're on our way to heaven. We're on our way to that which never ends. We seek a kingdom whose builder and maker is God. Would rather live in tents than the ivory palaces of men, lest we forget and leave out our senses of who God has called us to be and made us to be. If we'll give ourselves over, we'll bind whatever we'll bind and desire to see bound, and God will do it on our behalf in the heavens. Amen. If we'll walk and surrender here to Him, we'll loose whatever we desire, and God will loose it in the realms of heaven. It's true. If we'll obey God, we'll begin to step over into the relationship that He ordained us to have, and whatever we ask Him, it will be made manifest in the earth. And suddenly, humanity will begin to have a witness of the kingdom of God. Heaven will step into the reality of everyday living. Amen. And it begins with the way that you are going to do with what God has already placed within the framework of your ability. Whether it's your job, your car, God gave you your car to go pick up the lost. If every church across America would do nothing but take their car, go pick up people who want to come to church but doesn't have a transportation, the churches of America would be full and multiply. Everybody's turned to his own way, saying they're following Jesus. Everybody's doing their own thing, said they laid down their life. Man, if God laid down His life for us the way that most of His people have laid down their life for Him, we'd all be lost. We'd be in trouble. He ever lives to make intercession for us. My goodness, what a value he's placed upon prayer. Oh, that God's church can begin to have prayer meetings and prayer vigils again. Touch heaven. Begin to commune with him. Watch as the earth gets shaken by the power of the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, it not all's lost in the United States of America. Not all's lost. There's still plenty of time for the church to arise in the brightness of the King. Hallelujah. I feel revival. I feel the shakings of God. While I was there in New London, one of the oldest churches in America that still is standing today, built in the 1780s, you know, I could just feel the shakings of God. I could feel the visitation of the Spirit of the Lord coming into the 13 colonies. I could feel it. I could feel it. You know, I could feel the sweeping wind of heaven as it blows across like a mighty wind across the states of the United States of America and decimates everything in its way. Not by some political legislative agenda, but by an overwhelming Holy Ghost conviction that reaches in and grabs a hold and grips the heart of men and won't let go until they repent. It's true. It's happened over and again. God's the same God today, tomorrow, every day, yesterday, today, and forever. He has the same force of authority, same love and passion and mercy for people. He just got to have the same kind of troops on the ground. The same kind of response from those who say he's Lord, Master, and Sovereign Ruler. He must become sovereign ruler.
Amen.
We live by the word. We speak by the word. There's so much deception going on. I see a darkness of deception. And only the wind of the Spirit can blow those clouds away. A darkness of deception creeping in and taking a hold of the minds of God's people. Even in the Pentecostal movement, the place where the authority of God is there resident to be unleashed against the kingdom of darkness. People, if ever we've had a time of fasting and praying, getting rid of our leisure and all a little comfort of ease, it's now. If there's ever a time to quit being lukewarm and be all in, it's now. Because Father's about to move by his mighty power again. I mean, tell you, I know this with all of my heart. Papa's going to raise up a great and mighty army. That's a well-disciplined ranks of folk. I'm telling you, they're ferocious. They're radical. They're fully all in. They know half-steppers are completely committed. They got faces like a lion. Somebody said to me the other night, said, do you know when you preach, your eyes change colors? I don't know that my eyes change colors. They do. He said they change colors. And it's ferocious looking. I said, well, Papa's just raising up an army. And they got faces like lions. Amen. And they run like horses. I'm telling you, you learn how to walk and not be weary. You learn how to run and not be faint. And you'll mount up and start flying. I tell you, woo! There's a quick work. Satan, under his power and under his influence, was able to cause Alexander the Great to fly and sweep across the nation of the earth and capture them under a demonic realm. What happens if suddenly valiant men and women should be raised up with complete consecration to sit at the feet of the Holy Ghost? More than what Alexander the Great did when he sat at the feet of Aristotle to be taught how to be demon-possessed and fully given over to the powers of darkness. What happens if we give ourselves to be fully given over to the Spirit of the Lord? And we walk by the laws of the Spirit. We live by the Word. We don't allow sin in that will conflict us. If your heart convicts you, then, you know, God is even greater. But if your heart does not convict you, see, God says his rule and his way is bigger than your conscience and your heart. What he knows is a greater offense. Your sin's a greater offense to him than it is to you. That's what that means. He says, but if our heart does not convict, condemn, accuse us, because you could use all those words to translate that particular Greek word, he says, then we have confidence before God. Whatever we ask, he'll do it. Father's looking for some people to step into this kind of relationship. Quit diddle-dallying around with demon spirits. Get yourself some discernment and understand how full of destruction and hate those things are, that there is no pleasure there. If you've had a good time sipping from the septic system, wait till you taste what's going around at Father's table. Yeah. If you've had pleasures in death, wait till you step over and begin to partake of the pleasures in His life. Yeah. Hallelujah. The Spirit of the Lord grabs a hold of your heart and affections, and He won't let go, but you could grieve Him, and you can say no. But be of the heart and be of the kind that Christ Jesus reproduced when He made you in His image and in His likeness, when He gave to you this life divine. Give yourself over to being valiant for the Lord, zealous of good works. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Everybody, would you just stand with me? I got hours to preach. You know, the day they gave me the microphone in New London, Connecticut, I didn't know it was about a quarter till 12. And I got up, and I was so full of the power of God, I was out of breath. I said, I got 6 hours of things that I need to tell you, and I got to condense it into the next 45 minutes. I went over by an hour. Nearly. I went over by 45 minutes. And it's an hour and a half. And oh, I just praise God, because I'm like, right now, I'm just as amazed as anybody else at what God does when he shakes the place. And so I have a purpose in the local church to really build the local church. We're going to raise up people after the Jesus kind. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't think that I'm the Jesus kind, I got news for you. People talk about new breed. Hello. I am the Jesus kind. And I don't know what it is you got in your mind that you want to do, but we're asking you, come follow us as we follow Jesus. I'm saying, let there be no heroes. Let there be no person of fame in our life but Jesus Christ, and only in His name. But there's people you can follow. Quit acting like you. Start connecting with God. Start doing it His way. Act like Abraham. I tell you right now. Act like Jesus. Act like the Apostle Paul. Come on, man. Come on now. Let's get on with this program. Come on, let's get on with this program. Just all in for Jesus. Hallelujah. Watch God multiply it. Start being joyful all the time. Start being full. Don't be argumentative. Don't be a strife maker. Don't have offense. Don't have unforgiveness in your life. Choose God's way in every place, in every way. What? This is the good life that God will multiply. Hallelujah. Don't. You could, if need be, you can be sad all by yourself and no one can see you. But don't reproach Jesus in a public place. And especially when you get to church, come on, man. Let there be a greater exceeding joy. Hallelujah. And I know for some people, it's a battle. I know for some people, it's a battle, because that's a giant of oppression that you've never stood up against. Well, I'm going to tell you, you cry out to God, He'll give you a sword. Take the head of that thing. Amen. You'll walk around church prophesying, holding the head. Hold him head. Look at what God is able to do. Hallelujah. How about I say? Listen. Human resources have always been limited. The harvest truly is great. There will be a day that will come. We will be hated by everyone for His name's sake. Matthew chapter 10, Jesus said that in the light and the condition of the church. There will come a day where we will be hated of all nations, Matthew 24, for His name's sake. That day isn't right now. That day is yet in the future. There is a harvest to win. The night is coming when no man can work. The night is coming when no man can work. But that isn't that time right now. The night is coming when God will no longer extend His mercy to the nations, but judgment and wrath should be poured out. Not because there's people who still want Him, but because the grapes of wrath are fully ripe and there is no more harvest, men will develop a great resent against the Almighty God, that not even living 1,000 years with Him will be able to cleanse. Not even living with Him 1,000 years will be able to fix. That time is now. The harvest is great. The laborers are few. I cannot imagine being held responsible for you if I didn't tell you that you're going to not be happy with the plan and the way things work out. If you get to heaven, stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and found out that the majority of your life was lived for you. But oh, the rewards, oh, the glory, oh, the greatness. People, this is the time that we get to live biggest for God. I want to live fully for Him. Come on, people. There really shouldn't even be a concept in our mind of living less than fully for Him. All my job was, I worked a secular job bivocationally for 14 years. All my job was a means to support the church because I received no finances from the church. It was a means to support the church. That's all my job was about. I made more money before I went to school than I made afterwards for many years. My job was just about supporting the church. That's it. And I stayed there and I gave myself to everything I could do to be as effective as I possibly could be, to work as hard as I possibly could be because I need to leave a little bit early for the meeting. I didn't have much time to do anything but just give myself, just living out Jesus every day. One day, Papa said, I have need of you, more need of you. Because we had to church every night. He had need of me. I was busy in the meetings. I'd spend my lunch breaks. I'd go tell people about Jesus. I'd go pray on the beach. I'd go look. I'd ask God. I'd say, Father, give me a divine appointment. As I walk in this place, show me the person that's ready. And you could do the same thing, too. That's why I'm telling you this. You don't have to quit your job. I had a guy, I was with a guy today. The Lord's doing great signs and wonders and miracles in his life. I mean, he's ready to go. He could go right now. He could go. He could go anywhere because of what God's doing in his life. And he says to me, he says, Pastor, what do you think I should do? I said, you got to serve until everybody else around you knows it's time as well. It's not control. It's just letting God prepare you fully so that when you go, and I want you to see this happen. I want to see this happen for you. I want to see every one of you step over into a realm where the Spirit of the Lord can fully be expressed through you. And it all begins by just being happy all the time. Yeah. Giving yourself to this wonderful things of heaven. Going out, reach. The Lord leaves the 99 religious and goes after the one looking for relationship. Give yourself to go and find that one person that you can pour your life into. If you was able to reach one person a year, after 10 years, you'd have 10 souls in the kingdom. What value is that? I told the Lord I'd go to these different nations for one soul. And every time I get there, there's tens of thousands. People say to me, they say, don't you see an indication that you're more effective in the nations and that you therefore have a greater anointing for the nations and should be in the nations? Well, you know what? I do have greater effectiveness in the nations. And the ministry that God's given me is an entirely different dynamic than it is here. Entirely different. Entirely different. But I'm obeying God and doing what God said for me to do. I'm not going to take any shortcuts. He always tells me, go back to the United States. And he's been telling me over and again, come back to San Diego. Now is all of a sudden, the Lord's saying, the nation, the United States of America. And that's a different dynamic than what goes on right here in this place. Because I just see Father wanting to take it and multiply it in every one of your lives. Every one of you. Hallelujah. Signs, wonders, miracles. Word of knowledge, the ability to just know what's going on in people's lives. Hallelujah. The ability to reach into their heart, just say like Jesus said to Nathaniel, I saw you when you were under the fig tree. My Lord and my God. He went from, can there be any good thing to come out of Nazareth? My Lord and my God. What a quick conversion over one word of knowledge. Oh, when it's from heaven. When it's touched the depths of the person's heart. When all of a sudden tongues and interpretation of tongues is back in the church.
Yes.
And all of a sudden everybody begins to prophesy again. Ah, oh, I was raised in that. Ha ha. Now I'm going to get excited here and start dancing around here in a minute. Hallelujah. Ah. When we begin to cry out to heaven and cooperate with God, the Holy Ghost, the way He's moving, and then people can't even driving by. People have come and told me they were driving by and something reached out and grabbed them. And even in the parking lot was dark like it is tonight, but they still came and investigated. Why? Because there's praying saints on the inside. How about if we take it to another level? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They might have been, they were from another country. We had one family, huge family come. They were from another country. We were here on vacation. They were driving by. God arrested them, brought them in. Everybody that was lost in their family got saved. They all went home. What a vacation. They came to stay together. Everybody gets saved. Hallelujah. Born again before they went to SeaWorld and Disneyland. If you just begin to just sow your life into the kingdom, Father will multiply it with beautiful and glorious and wonderful things. Listen, girls, I want to say this to you, young people, those of you especially sitting right in, standing right in here. Last Sunday, I saw you worshiping, and the Spirit of the Lord said to me, there's nothing more beautiful than those who sitting at my feet, totally yielded to me, desiring nothing other than to be fully filled with me. Just say, Lord, here am I. I just want to be used by you. I don't want anything else. I don't want anything. I don't need a husband. I don't need a wife. I don't need money. I don't need a job. I don't need all that stuff that the older generation needed. Hallelujah. I just want you. And I say that to the oldest person in this place, because it's never too late to step into your place in God. Father has a life. He's not just joking. It's not an exaggeration. It's an abundant life for you that superly abounds with everything that is good. Now unto Him who's able to do super abundantly above all that you can think or ask. I said unto Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly, or superly, as I like to say, abundantly above all. Listen, think of it above all you can think or ask, according to His power that is at work on the inside of you. But look, there's a prerequisite. Being willing to know the love of Christ. To give yourself to it. To yield to it. To give yourself to falling in love with everybody you meet in the first 3 seconds. Even the grouchy, grumpy, obnoxious. Even the religiously intolerant. Just fall in love with them. And cooperate with the Holy Ghost and let the Spirit of the Lord just flow out of you and begin to develop you to where He finds no hindrance nor restriction in being manifested in your life. Stay on your knees until you get yourself a smile. Instead of that half-paralyzed smile some of you have. I call it the stroke smile. You got halfway there, man. You should have prayed to you, did the glory came. Ha! 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 Watch what God will do with you as you just begin to cooperate with God on the very simplest levels. Cooperate with the Holy Ghost on the very simplest levels. And He'll show you how to make breakthroughs in the realms of the supernatural. He'll show you how to make the supernatural natural. He'll show you how to boat a steraina. He'll show you how to captivate the attention of men. I guarantee you, I'm telling you right now, when people start getting healed and touched by the power of God, the way God the Holy Ghost wants to do it, they'll be following you to church. You won't have to pick them up. They'll say, what? Can I stay with you? Please don't go out of my sight. They'll be trying to bless you, give you money, all sorts of stuff. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I promise you, what God wants to do through your life is just like what he did through Jesus. You got to quit bathing yourself in all these congratulations because you smiled. And all these congratulations because you actually broke out and told someone about Jesus that you weren't threatened by. That you actually prayed for somebody and they got out of pain for a minute. And now it's time to go and celebrate. No, man, it's time to, come on now. Come on, it's time to get a breakthrough over here. Hallelujah. The world's standing around waiting for breakthroughs in medical science. We're supposed to be standing around waiting for breakthroughs in the realms of the spirit. And we are the ones engaged. Everybody raise your hand towards heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Father, thank you for the anointing. Super anointed. Masalakatera Shapate. Moto Sivriti. Lastatevi. Ha ha. Monday, Xtili per Esusurita. Ha ha ha. Hallelujah. Signs, wonders, miracles. Demonstration of the power of God. Great authority. Ha! Great authority. Woo! Mama Naya. Woo! Great authority. Sarabai. Great authority. Ashalamani. Great authority. Ha! Haladasateya. Ha! Don't miss out on your place. Don't let somebody else take your place. You press in. You won't be amazed what happens. People gonna look at you. People gonna look at you and they're gonna say, you're not of this world. Ha! You won't have to be saying anymore, I'm not of this world. They're gonna be looking at you, you're not of this world. Ha ha ha. Ooh, Ramadaya. Ooh, Sitaramaya. Fire of the Holy Ghost! The great outpouring of the Spirit of the Lord! The great incoming of the harvest in Jesus' name! Multiply! Multiply! Increase! And the increase of God in Jesus' name! Increase! I command a blessing on you now! I command a blessing! Blessing in your finances, a blessing in your health, a blessing in the realms of your understanding of how to move in the Holy Ghost, how to move with God, how to rise up against temptation, how to rise up against the offense of Satan. Be more than a conqueror. Ah. Let the word of God abide in you and defeat Satan at every point. To this live, this glory, where you're like a city set upon a hill that cannot be hid. Where you're like the sun shining in its brightness at noonday. Where the glory of Christ Jesus is being made manifest through our lives in every way. Simple obedience to God. You don't have to earn it. You don't have to deserve it. Simple obedience to His Word. Just simple obedience to the laws of the Spirit of life. Father, just take you there. Father, will take us there. will see every single person healed that we pray for. See the power of God. I know. The power of God comes upon everybody I talk to. I'm there consciously cooperating with the Holy Ghost, who in His love and mercy poured out His Spirit upon all flesh. I've got a hold of the heavenly vision that God gave to the Apostle Paul, that He's given to all of us, to open up the eyes of the blind. Just while I'm talking to you, while you're talking to them, Chrissy, no matter what's going on, no matter what you see, no matter what outward evidence, you've opened up the eyes of the blind. You've turned them from darkness to light. You've brought them out of the grip of Satan, brought them into the power of God, so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among all the saints in light. They may not accept Jesus right there. They may not be willing to fall down and repent right there. We would that every man and every woman, every boy, every girl would respond in such a way. But still, the change of atmosphere from hell to heaven, from earth to the realms of glory has taken place because you let come out of your mouth this word of life, this gospel of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus, I would tell you right tonight, this will be more effective in your life than ever before. I had a preacher recently ask me, he said, how long do we continue to deal with people? I said, as long as God is. He said, how do you know that He's not dealing with them anymore? Because they don't want to hear, they don't want to see you anymore. They don't want to see you, they don't want to see God. They're given over to a place where they do not want to retain the knowledge of God. But until then, you pursue and passionately pursue and love them, call them. Let God make you valiant tonight. You know, I think one of the greatest prayers that you can pray for yourself or pray over anyone is that they be strengthened by the Holy Spirit in their inner being. Why don't you let God do that for you tonight? So that all the other interests aren't so big and important to you anymore. So that you being a representative of you, whatever that isn't so glamorous anymore. That being a representative of heaven is like, I get to be. To move from the self realm to the realms of the Spirit. From yielding to our own will and desires to yielding to His will and His desires. Let the power of God just touch you right now. Let Him make you more emotional than you've ever been. Some of you are so quiet. Father wants to touch you so deeply. Let Papa touch you so deeply. Son, touch you. Then touch you. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I want you to do this, dear people. I want you to find a bunch of people around you. I want you to hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in the name of Jesus. Just find people to pray with tonight, tomorrow. Give yourself to seeking first the things of the kingdom of God. Do this. No more pretending. No more, oops, I forgot. Go after the things of the kingdom. Go after the love that's in Father's heart for the lost. Watch what God will do if you let Him. Manansa de kidambra bevele vet isela na mambra beve ala busuta. Mi andala la lavasara da bale le kere ma manza la surre de cara da bayir si torrono. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Hallelujah! Oh, Surama Mandel, Mosutara Maker, Mamosita Lor, Mamosicala Bayeo, Mamania. So, Rimasitari, Masatori, Masako, Yamamia. Your glory now, your power now, your signs, your wonders, oh God. So, Masiomi, the Lobokaya, Boso Bahaya, Lipehe. The great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we worship you and praise and thank you, oh God, for the things that you're doing in the earth. Where you reveal heaven through our lives, oh God. Where you live the glory, reveal the glory of your own self through our lives, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Mondora, Mondero, Musuro, Mungibo, Imambeto. Mambea, Vasita, Malakoya. Donki Ramashanti, Yalobokomo, Ndo, Yopongea, Sipaneapi. Mondala, Boko, Rabate, La Mongea, Tishila, Noya. These things the Lord pleads with men to allow. Men do not plead with him. He cries forth and lifts up his voice that though there would be a people that would come and be taught of him, who would sit at his feet and learn how to move in the mind of the Spirit and the things of the kingdom. Hallelujah. If there's anybody you want prayer for anything, sickness in your body, problems in your spirit, torment in your mind. Maybe there's someone in here, you've never given your life to Jesus Christ. God wants to introduce himself to you today. He wants to change everything about your way. He wants to come upon you with his glory and his power and bring forth heaven through your life. Hallelujah. All you got to do is come to the cross of Calvary. Lose your life and you'll have his. Let God take a hold of you and a whole new life begins. The life begins, actually, until you have Christ Jesus, you dead while you live. So it's time to start living. Amen. I'm here to pray for anybody. Let's pray for anybody who wants prayer for anything. Hallelujah. Watch what God will do. Praise God. You just get up here in front of him. My goodness, let power of heaven come and take hold of you. Spirit of the Lord come shake you. Hallelujah.